Now touching tributes and respects paid to Her Majesty the Queen as BBC One reflects on the events of the day.
Good evening from Buckingham Palace. At the end of a day which combined the solemn majesty of a royal procession with the uplifting gratitude of a vast crowd who wanted to pay tribute to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II. The Queen's coffin was taken on an ancient gun carriage, escorted by the troops of the Household Division, and followed on foot by the King and senior members of the royal family. The Queen's body is now lying in state at Westminster Hall, where members of the public are able to file past and pay their respects for days to come. My colleagues Petroch Trelawney and First Fergal Keane watch today's events.
We've come through days of journeys, each representing a final goodbye to places where the Queen was loved and which she loved. Here at Wellington Barracks, the troops of the Household Division, the monarch's personal guard since 1660, are about to make the short journey to Buckingham Palace, from where they'll accompany the Queen's coffin to Westminster Hall for her lying in state. This cortege includes troops from the Life Guards and Blues and Royals, the King's Guard, the Guard of Honour, and a bearer party from the 1st Grenadier Guards. All will march to the bands of the Grenadier Guards and the Scots Guards. This will be the Queen's final departure from Buckingham Palace, from where she witnessed the celebrations on VE Day after the defeat of Nazi Germany in 1945, and where, this June, she acknowledged the crowd celebrating 70 years of her reign. We're seeing the marching detachments of the Life Guards and Blues and Royals, marching now through the gates of Wellington Barracks. Household cavalry are marching, they're on foot, not for symbolic reasons, but purely aesthetic, so that they don't in any sense distract from or overshadow the gun carriage. Grenadier Guards moving out towards Buckingham Palace, and now the gun carriage on which will be borne the coffin of Her Majesty the Queen. The George gun was used for the funeral ceremonies of Her Majesty's father, George VI, in 1952, and her mother, Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, 50 years later, in 2002. King's Troop Royal Horse Artillery gun carriage. They have six World War I era 13-pounder guns that were built between 1913 and 1918. The George gun is the only one that is a complete original. We have the bands of the Grenadier Guards and the Scots Guards. They're led by Tony Williams, the Director of Music and Officer Commanding the Scots Guards Band. They will be playing music from Chopin, Beethoven, and Felix Mendelssohn, who, during the 19th century, played three times for the royal family at Buckingham Palace. And now, drawn up inside the forecourt of Buckingham Palace, detachments of the Life Guards and the Blues and Royals. And the King's Guard, the Guard of Honour, is already in position in front of Buckingham Palace Gate. And the crowds here, as I discovered walking through them earlier, people gathered together, a very diverse group, thousands of people, with that sense of being part of something larger than themselves, one of these very rare moments in the life of a nation where there is this sense of a national binding together, in grief, of course, but also in gratitude. Young and old. And now the King's Troop of the Royal Horse Artillery are deploying in Hyde Park, from where they will fire the minute guns. Every minute to remember, to draw the capital to attention. And here at Wellington Barracks, soldiers, sailors and airmen of the Tri-Service Guard of Honour now depart for Parliament Square. Band of the Royal Marines, led by Lieutenant Colonel Jason Bertram, Principal Director of Music of the Royal Marines. Soon now we expect the coffin to emerge from Buckingham Palace. The bearer party has carried the coffin, led by the Sovereign's Piper, through the Marble Hall and the Grand Hall. And from there, it will be taken by the Guard of Honour to the gun carriage. Already in the bow room, the crown jeweller has placed the imperial state crown on the coffin, and the royal florist has placed a fresh wreath of flowers. Thank you. is reversed in respect for the monarch. Passing under the Great Arch for the last time, Queen Elizabeth II. Following the coffin as it leaves Buckingham Palace, King Charles and senior members of the royal family. The King is wearing the full-day ceremonial uniform with the rank of Field Marshal and carrying the Field Marshal's baton presented to him by the Queen when he became Field Marshal in 2012. Thank you. we hear the steady beating of the drum, the ringing of Big Ben, and the minute guns. These sounds echoing across the capital. This day of most solemn duty for a king and a son. Poignant to reflect that the Mall was most recently the backdrop for the Queen's Jubilee celebrations in June. The end of those celebrations also marked the last time the Queen appeared on Buckingham Palace balcony when crowds flooded the Mall. Commanding officer of the gun carriage is Captain Amy Cooper, 31 years old. She's the only mounted officer today. She's riding the horse Lord Firebrand. Thank you. cortege now passing statues of King George VI and Queen Mother. The bronze statue of the Queen Mother, who died in 2002, aged 101, was unveiled by Her Majesty the Queen in February 2009. The cortege now moves down towards Horse Guards Parade, the place where the Queen celebrated her birthday with the Trooping of the Colour. The flags of the Commonwealth, that organisation which was so important in the life of Queen Elizabeth. Now departing Buckingham Palace, the Queen Consort and the Princess of Wales, Duchess of Sussex and Countess of Wessex, leaving from the grand entrance, and they are travelling to the Palace of Westminster, where they will be ready to meet the cortege. Cortege now entering Horse Guards Parade. Applause there in appreciation of the Queen's life, mingled of course with the grief natural to a moment like this. under the archway and briefly out of the sunlight. But the constant, steady beat of the drum, that metronome of grief. Now emerges onto Whitehall for the last part of the journey towards Westminster. Passing the cenotaph, unveiled in 1920 in the aftermath of the Great War, and where Her Majesty came year after year in November to remember the dead. members of the royal family now, saluting as they pass the cenotaph. As the procession arrives at Parliament Square, the Tri-Service Guard of Honour is waiting with colours draped from the RAF, the Army and the Navy. And passing the statue of Sir Winston Churchill, who had a particularly close bond with the Queen. He was her first Prime Minister. When he retired in 1959, she wrote to him, "I will forever be able to hold the place of my first Prime Minister, to whom both my husband and I so much. I shall always be so profoundly grateful." The gun carriage has now arrived at the Palace of Westminster, where the Queen will lie in state until her funeral next Monday. The guards removing the bearskin hats in preparation for the carrying of the coffin.
Bearer party, 8 soldiers from Queen's Company of the 1st Battalion, Grenadier Guards. 8 young men charged with this most public of duties. And from within Westminster Hall comes the sound of the choirs of the Chapel Royal and Westminster Abbey, singing a setting of Psalm 139. O Lord, thou hast searched me out and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and mine uprising. Words sung 20 years ago as the coffin of Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, was carried into this hall.
Then shall my life be O God, the Maker and Redeemer of all mankind, grant us, with thy servant Queen Elizabeth and all the faithful departed, the sure benefits of thy Son's saving passion and glorious resurrection, that in the last day, when all things are gathered up in Christ, we may with them enjoy the fullness of thy promises. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
O merciful God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, in whom whosoever believeth shall live, though he die, and whosoever liveth and believeth in him shall not die eternally, who also hath taught us, by his holy apostle St. Paul, not to be sorry, as men without hope, for them that sleep in him. We meekly beseech thee, O Father, to raise us from the death of sin unto the life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we may rest in him, as our hope is that our sister doth, and that at the general resurrection in the last day, we may be found acceptable in thy sight, and receive that blessing which thy well-beloved Son shall then pronounce to all who love and fear thee, saying, Come, ye blessed children of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. Grant this, we beseech thee, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our Mediator and Redeemer.
Amen.
As our Saviour Christ hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. O God, the protector of all who trust in thee, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us thy mercy, that thou, being our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal that we finally lose not things eternal. Grant this, O Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen.
Unto God's gracious mercy and protection we commit you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
The service led by the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Most Reverend Justin Welby, and the Dean of Westminster, Dr. David Hoyle. The Choir of the Chapel Royal and the Choir of Westminster Abbey, conducted by James O'Donnell. And it was his setting of the psalm that we heard as the Queen's coffin was carried in. Psalm 139, a setting inspired by the Orthodox Kontakion for the Dead. The Cross of Westminster is placed at the head of the coffin. cross, a gift to the abbey a century ago. It bears a Latin inscription: "Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more." The colour royal standard of Queen's Company, 1st Battalion, Grenadier Guards. The standard presented to the guards by the sovereign on commencement of their reign, not changed or replaced since then, only paraded in the sovereign's presence. For the last time, it's lowered, a solemn salute to the Queen from her company and from her Grenadiers. Six feet of heavily embroidered and tasseled silk, everything to maneuver gently into position. The guardsmen who serve in the Queen's company, known fondly as members of the Monarch's Mob. Several of the guardsmen returned on Friday from service in Iraq, called back to do their duty. So we prepare for the first vigil, first 6-hour watch, 20 watches in total between now and the moment on Monday morning when Her Late Majesty's coffin is carried to Westminster Abbey for the funeral. Gentlemen at Arms, a bodyguard established by Henry VIII in 1509, wearing the uniform of a heavy dragoon guards officer of the 1840s, their helmets with white swan feather plumes. And 4 officers from the Household Cavalry. The lifeguards, white plumes on their helmets, the blues and royals with red plumes. Take their positions on the corner of the catafalque. And a double tap from the stick of the officer of the watch, commanding the procedure of the watch, the start, the finish, and the rotation of the guard. Black rod, Lord Speaker and the Speaker of the House of Commons lead the procession out of Westminster Hall, passing by the coffin. The Earl Marshal, the 18th Duke of Norfolk, he leads the King and the Royal Party. To the left of the Earl Marshal, Lord Carrington, the Lord Great Chamberlain. Prince of Wales in his RAF uniform. Canterbury cross there held by the chaplain to the Archbishop of Canterbury, Tosino de Dupo. King and Queen Consort depart the Palace of Westminster to return to Clarence House. the heralds. Noran Ulster, King of Arms, read the proclamation at Hillsborough Castle. Lord Lyon, the sole King of Arms in Scotland, who read the proclamation at the Merkert Cross in Edinburgh. And Clancy, King of Arms, who read the proclamation at the Royal Exchange in the City of London after the principal proclamation on Saturday. Choristers from the Chapel Royal and the Choir of Westminster Abbey. The Chapel Royal choristers in red and gold. And the men of the Chapel Royal wearing those distinctive white bow ties. The choristers now return to the choir school at Westminster Abbey, where they will prepare for their role in Monday's funeral. The anthem they sang, by the way, by Edward Best, "O Jesu, the very thought of thee," Best, a great Yorkshireman, born in Huddersfield, organist of York Minster for more than three decades until his death in 1946. This hall, 900 years old, more than 900 years. The largest hall in England, probably the largest hall in Europe when it was built under the instructions of William II, the son of William the Conqueror, in 1097. And ever since then, part of our national story. A place where feasts and banquets, court masks, jousting tournaments took place. A market hall for 500 years from the 13th century. A diarist, parliamentarian, Samuel Pepys used to purchase books, gloves, and caps from one of its stalls. William Gladstone, the first person to lie in state here in 1898. 1965, Winston Churchill rested here. Edward VII in 1910, George V in 1936, George VI in 1952. Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, rested here for 3 days before her funeral in April 2002. Black Rod, Sarah Clark. Leading the slow parade past the coffin. Minister and leader of the opposition emerge into the sunlight, walking through the thick sand carefully laid outside this building to enable the gun carriage to come to a perfect halt. Woe betide anyone who stepped upon it before the arrival of Her Late Majesty, a team of men with rakes to ensure it was perfectly presented. As the parliamentarians leave, they pass the fountain that was placed here in honour of Her Late Majesty's Silver Jubilee in 1977. A moment in Westminster Hall. The building will be closed for approximately an hour. And then the first members of the public, many of whom have been queuing already for several nights, will be allowed in to file past the coffin. Last night, Her Majesty rested at Buckingham Palace, her last night in the residence that she knew throughout her 96 years. Focus of private family grief. But that now changes to republic grief, as her subjects have the chance to pay their respects. As many as 750,000 people may pass through here between now and the state funeral on Monday. Well, some of the people that we're seeing coming in now have been queuing for two nights, waiting to ensure their place very front of the line of those anxious to spend a moment walking around the coffin. I never know what this means to each and every person here. Respect for the monarch. Perhaps also transference of personal grief. And a deep sympathy for the monarch's children. That shared experience of losing parents that many of us will know. People have just made a short journey to be here from London and its suburbs. Others have travelled much further. I've heard accounts of people who have made long international flights in order to be here. One person saying that they'd known Her Majesty the Queen, that she'd been part of their life for all their life, that they wanted to come here to pay final respects and end what they considered their shared story. So from now until Monday morning, the people will come here, will file past the bier with Her Majesty's coffin resting on top. BBC is launching a live stream of the lying in state for people who are unable to be here and want to pay their respects virtually. It's available now on the BBC homepage, on the BBC News website and app, on the iPlayer, the red button, and also on the BBC Parliament channel. And that live stream will be on air all the time that members of the public are allowed into Westminster Hall. night and day as they come to pay their respects to Queen Elizabeth II.
So in the days and nights ahead, many thousands of people from all parts of Britain and the Commonwealth and beyond are expected to take the opportunity to visit Westminster Hall, to file past the coffin, an experience surely that none of them will ever forget. We will be at Westminster Abbey on Sunday evening, on the eve of the first state funeral in the United Kingdom since that of Sir Winston Churchill back in 1965. And the final committal will be at St. George's Chapel, Windsor, closing one of the most illustrious chapters in the history of the British monarchy. So from all of the BBC team at Buckingham Palace, it's good night.